Johnson. I'm the dean here at the school to welcome all of you. Our Juris in Residence Lecture is always one of our signature events and is very important to us, and we thank all of you, and we thank PCN also for coming to join us today. I'd now like to turn the time over to Jill Family, who's the director of our Law and Government program here, to introduce our speaker.
Hello, thank you all so much for coming to our annual Jurist in Residence Lecture. After my brief introduction, the lecture will take place for about an hour, including some time for questions at the end. And then after the lecture, I invite all of you to join us for a reception in the gallery. Thank you to Dean Johnson for your support of the Law and Government Institute. Thank you as well to my faculty colleagues, our alumni, who are always such great and constant supporters of the Institute. I also want to thank Sandy Grafe for all of her help in putting this event together, as well as Brian Fernball, our Law and Government Student Fellow, Jenna Moscato, who you probably met on your way in, as well as our Patrick Murphy Fellows, Sia Georgiakopoulos, and Lindsay Eichinger, who's right there. The Law and Government Institute here at Widener Law Commonwealth is dedicated to the study of government law. We like to take a look at how government works, including specifically the role of lawyers in government. At Widener, students may earn a certificate in law and government in addition to their JD, and the experience in pursuing the certificate allows them to have hands-on experience learning about the role that lawyers play in government law. And the Institute is proud to sponsor the Jurist in Residence Lecture, and we're thrilled to welcome back our Jurist in Residence Commonwealth Court Judge Kevin P. Brobson. Judge Brobson is an alumnus of our law school, and we are so proud to have him as our Jurist in Residence. This is Judge Brobson's second year out of a two-year term, although, you know, maybe we could make it 20 years. It's his second year of a two-year term as our Jurist in Residence. He has been a wonderful influence for our law school, and we cannot thank him enough for his service. In addition to this yearly lecture, Judge Brobson is teaching a class on the intersections of the rights to know and to privacy. Please join me in welcoming Commonwealth Court Judge Kevin Brobson.
Good evening, everyone. First of all, go Eagles. Just wanted to get that out of the way. Thank you, Dean Johnson, Professor Family, Widener Commonwealth Law School, for the opportunity to be the Jurist in Residence. Last year, I was able to stand up here and give my first lecture as the Jurist in Residence on the intersection of the right to privacy and governmental transparency, and it was sort of one of those really cerebral academic lectures, because when I got named as the Jurist in Residence, I had to do some searching as to what kind of lectures Jurists in Residence give. And I looked around the internet and YouTube and everything, and they were all so smart. You know, they were just brilliant, brilliant, brilliant judges. So I felt like, well, I have to do this sort of really cerebral lecture as a Jurist in Residence. So I did my research and did this presentation on the right to privacy and governmental transparency. So when I came to try to figure out a topic for this lecture, I didn't really want to do the same thing. I felt like I needed to give something that was a little bit more nuts and bolts, a little bit more practical. But I did kind of discard some topics. One of the topics I did discard was the rule against perpetuities. I figured that the lecture would just go on forever. And I also discarded gerrymandering because I wanted something that was timely. And that just didn't seem good. So what I came up with was judging judges, or the state of judicial discipline in Pennsylvania. Why did I choose that topic? Well, there are a couple of reasons. One, in August of 2015, the Pennsylvania Supreme Court appointed me as the appellate judge member of the Judicial Conduct Board. So I've had some experience over the last couple of years in the area of judicial discipline and judicial conduct in Pennsylvania. So I felt like I had something I could, some information that I could impart upon viewers and the people in the audience. The other reason was we just finished a judicial election in Pennsylvania, and there's going to be more judicial elections in Pennsylvania. And when I ran back in 2009, there was sort of this theme, and it's a theme that happens, I think, invariably in every judicial election. And the idea is about restoring trust and confidence in the judiciary and integrity, and those kind of a themes. And it just sort of seems that happens. And again, that was a theme this past time. So, you know, when I ran, it was all about the Kids for Cash scandal that happened up in Luzerne County. After that, there was the Philadelphia Traffic Court, and of course, since I have been a judge, we've seen several resignations from the Supreme Court and changeover in the Supreme Court due to various different scandals or what have you on that court. So a lot of questions get raised in that process, and when you see such a turnover, particularly on our Supreme Court, but in other judicial positions throughout Pennsylvania, is, you know, who's guarding the hen house, so to speak? How are these things happening? Well, I think the answer to the very simple but basic answer to that is we're electing human beings to these positions, and you know, human beings are fallible. And so the question, though, is what backstop do we have in Pennsylvania to ensure that when our judges fail, that there's something there to judge them by and to take care of those situations where a judge has failed the public? So that's why I thought it was important to do this. Before I go into that, I do have some thanks I have to give. I want to thank my wife, who couldn't be here again this year, because she again is out running my children around. So I appreciate that, honey. Thank you very much for supporting me and supporting the kids. I also, some people who attended lecture last year will remember that I included some pictures of my children. Just have to. I'm very proud of my kids. But I didn't include any pictures this year. But one thing I do want to say is I'm very proud of my daughter, who is finishing up her senior year at Bishop McDevitt High School. She's going to college next year. So, Claire, I'm very proud of you. Thank you very much. So I was a little rushed in coming up with this topic and this presentation and the name of the title of the presentation. So I came up with this sort of judging judges thing, which is a little bit of alliteration. But after going through various judicial installations that have been happening since we elected 7 statewide judges, I came up with a different title. So it's, if you shall so long behave yourself well. I don't know how many of you here have ever attended an installation of a judge in Pennsylvania. If you have, raise your hand. So there's a point in the installation where someone gets up and reads the commission from the governor. And it has a lot of, you know, heretofore and know ye and a lot of words that I don't really understand. But everybody's listening, it's like, oh, so wonderful, and we're all smiling and everything like that. And in the end, the last thing that is in the commission is this phrase, if you shall so long behave yourself well. And everybody laughs, right? Everybody kind of giggles. But it's actually a pretty good title, because what that means is it really does help to impart upon everyone that this position as a judge, or any elected official for that matter, is a position of trust. It's a position that is very important to the people of Pennsylvania. And so if you shall so long behave yourself well is a reference to the fact of you have to hold in your heart and in your everyday work the highest integrity in everything that you do. And that's why I thought it was apropos to change the title. I'm not gonna really get into a lot about specifically about ethics. This isn't really an ethics lecture in the sense of substantive rules of ethics that apply to judges. We're going to cover that a little bit, but really what I'm hoping to do is provide the nuts and bolts of the process, because if there's anything that I've realized after becoming a Judicial Conduct Board member, having been a judge, and having been out in the public before that, is I don't think we all have, you know, the general public has a really good understanding about how this whole process works, about who are the very people that you can complain to about judicial misconduct, and who are the very people that investigated, and who are the very people that ultimately decide whether misconduct has occurred and what kind of sanction should be implemented. So this is sort of a nuts and bolts lecture, an effort to demystify this whole process, and hopefully those of you who are in attendance and those of you who are watching by PCN will have a better understanding of how that process works in Pennsylvania. So, as I indicated, judges in Pennsylvania are held to a high standard of conduct. And like everything I talk about when it comes to the law or standards governing elected officials, we always start with the Constitution. So here in Pennsylvania Constitution, Article 5, Section 17, this is the authorization of the Pennsylvania Constitution for the Pennsylvania Supreme Court to create governing codes of conduct for the judges in Pennsylvania. And they have done just that. They've created the Code of Judicial Conduct, which regulates the Supreme Court justices themselves. It also regulates the Superior Court and Commonwealth Court judges, Common Pleas Court judges, and Philadelphia Municipal Court judges. There's a separate set of rules that the Supreme Court has enacted dealing with magisterial district judges. Magisterial district judges in Pennsylvania, as many of you know, are sort of the bottom level of the pyramid of judiciary in Pennsylvania. They do incredibly important work in our communities whether it's small claims or arraignments or traffic violations or things of that, landlord-tenant disputes, very important role. But you don't have to be a lawyer to be a magisterial district judge in Pennsylvania. So they have this sort of separate code of conduct. They go through separate training. They have requirements for continued training and particularly training on ethics. Now, over the last several years and iterations of the Code of Judicial Conduct and the rules governing standards of conduct for magisterial district judges, the rules have somewhat become very similar. There's a lot of overlap. But for purposes of the discussion today and for purposes of sort of giving that high-level review of the rules that govern judicial conduct, I'm going to stick to the Code of Judicial Conduct. The canons are not the only place, though, that you can go wrong. There actually is a substantive provision in the Pennsylvania Constitution separate from the canons that judges also are guided by. And you can see here in Section 18 of the Pennsylvania Constitution the other violations where you can be held accountable for your conduct as a judge. Of course, the sanction here is be suspended, removed from office, or otherwise disciplined, but for conviction of a felony, that seems sort of obvious, but it's actually in the Pennsylvania Constitution. Violations of Section 17, which is a reference to the last section I had up dealing with the canons and Code of Judicial Conduct. Misconduct of an office, negligent or failure to perform duties of office. But this is the reason why I wanted to put this slide up. Whether or not the conduct occurred while acting in a judicial capacity or is prohibited by law. This is an underlying point of the judicial code that a lot of people don't understand. I am a judge of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania 24/7. When I go out in public, whether it's here or whether it's at a friend's house watching a football game, I am a judge of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. And I think most people appreciate and understand that, but it's not just something that we should expect. It's something that's actually enshrined in the Pennsylvania Constitution. And in that regard, there's also a very important phrase in this provision as well that some people have heard before, and that's about bringing the judicial office into disrepute. Again, sort of a very general term, but a very strong term as well. And what that means, again, is in all ways you should conduct yourself in a way that builds confidence in the judiciary and do not engage in any activities that look poorly on the judiciary, this institution that we as Pennsylvanians rely on so much. Turning to the code itself, there are sort of some overriding principles in the Code of Judicial Conduct. And they're set forth in the preamble of the Code of Judicial Conduct. And again, I'm not going to go through all of these, but I want to give you a sense of the theme, because there are some themes that sort of underlie the Code of Judicial Conduct. Again, the idea of a fair and impartial, competent judiciary filled with integrity. Integrity is a theme you'll see throughout the Code of Judicial Conduct. You'll see throughout the decisions of the Supreme Court in this area. It's a very important word and a very important theme. To treat and honor the judicial office as a matter of public trust. I feel very fortunate every day that I get to go work in the Pennsylvania Judicial Center and to work on the Commonwealth Court and to be a judge of Pennsylvania. It is not something that I have a right to. It is something that is absolutely a privilege. And you have to treat the office as a public trust. And again, I pointed out that we'll see in the themes that, you know, this is judges upholding the dignity of the office at all times. Again, in the Constitution, I am a judge 24/7. In the Code of Judicial Conduct, I am a judge 24/7. And all judges have to approach their jobs that way. The Code of Judicial Conduct is organized by, in three sort of subset of ways. First, you have sort of the overriding canon, or rule for that matter, followed by several sub-rules, and then, of course, there are comments. I'm not going to go through any of them, but I'm going to sort of give you all of them. I'm going to give sort of an abridged version of what the Code of Judicial Conduct looks like. So we're going canon, rule, and comment. The first canon is judicial image. This is, again, the reference to, at all times, judges are required to maintain the image and dignity of their office. Don't break the law or the canons. Yes, judges should not jaywalk. Judges should not DUI. Judges should not park at an expired meter. I mean, everything's relative, right? I mean, we're not going to knock a judge out of office for jaywalking. But the idea is if our judicial officers are responsible for implementing and enforcing the laws, the judicial officers should comply with the laws. Promote public confidence in office at all times. And again, something very important where some judges have run afoul of it in the past is don't abuse the prestige of office. Don't go around and flout the fact that you're a judge, or particularly seek any kind of special privilege because you happen to be a judge, regardless of what level of the judiciary you're at. Canon 2, judicial behavior. So canon 1 is judicial image. That applies all the time. Canon 2 is judicial behavior. This refers to your conduct as a judge. And of course, there's some priorities here. Judicial duties first, be fair and impartial, no bias, prejudice, or harassment. The harassment is also very important and very timely. This isn't just a matter of preventing harassment within your judicial chambers or within your staff, but judges are actually responsible for policing harassment in the courtroom, or policing harassment between lawyers in proceedings in front of them. It's to maintain the dignity and integrity of the judicial process. So for that reason, judges have an absolute responsibility to maintain decorum and ensure that harassment is not occurring in matters that come before them. So they have to monitor lawyers' conduct, and if they see some conduct that crosses the line of harassment, they need to correct it. Now we get to three off-bench activities, and you sort of see how this all lays out. So you have canon 1, judicial image, all the time. Canon 2, judicial behavior in your actions specifically as a judge. Canon 3, off-bench activities. So canon 3 in your off-bench activities is, of course, you want to minimize the risk of conflict. So you should avoid engaging in activities off the bench that you know will require you to conflict yourself out or recuse from a proceeding. Your duty and obligation, as indicated in one of the prior canons, is actually to do your job first. So you should avoid any situations that might prevent you from doing your job. Bar's affiliations with discriminatory organizations, that goes without saying. So you have to monitor your activities, make sure you're not within any organizations that discriminate against women, for example, minorities, organizations that have gender identity discrimination. These are the things that you have to be very careful to monitor in your private activities. Limitations on outside civic and charitable activities. This one causes a lot of controversy because we want our judges to still be part of their communities, right? We're still elected officials, but we're still members of our community. Some judges, before they get elected, are on nonprofit boards. And then the question comes up, well, do you have to resign from a nonprofit board when you become elected a judge? The answer is no, but what you cannot do is run afoul of the canons with regard to your participation in charitable activities. And what does that mean? Well, you can't use the prestige of your office to benefit the organization. So one way that could happen is you're on the board and they want to present you with some kind of an award, and they make it a public spectacle, and they have dinner, and they sell tickets, and they're honoring the honorable such and such, insert the blank. That is something that the code frowns upon. In addition, you should not raise money for the charitable organization, because the concern would be if you're soliciting funds as a judge, then the person may know you as a judge and may feel, well, you know, if I give the judge money, maybe the judge will remember those kinds of things. So the limitations on charitable activities are very important. There was some debate, it was interesting listening to some of the debate of the Supreme Court candidates this last time around, because One of the questions that keeps coming up in the debates by the media is the issue of a gift ban. And I really wanted to kind of reach through the screen and grab some of the candidates and help them with an answer, because there actually is a gift ban of sorts in the canons. And I mean, the language is right here. A judge shall not accept any gifts, loans, bequests, benefits, or other things of value if acceptance is prohibited by law or would appear to a reasonable person to undermine the judge's independence, integrity, or impartiality. And that's a theme, again, throughout the canons in terms of recusal, in terms of conflicts, and it's here in terms of gifts. Is the question is really not whether you can accept the gift and still believe that you, as a judge, can handle the case fairly and impartial. The question is what a reasonable person would believe. So there is a gift ban. There are some exceptions to it, particularly in exceptions for friends and lawyers. But what's interesting about that exception is okay so long as the type of gift that you would end up recusing yourself for. So if I have a friend of mine who is a lawyer, and we have been friends for a long time, and that friend decides to give me a very generous, expensive gift over the holiday, there's really nothing wrong with me accepting it so long as I realize that he is such a good friend that I'm going to recuse myself from all the cases anyway. Because ultimately, that's what we're trying to prevent, right? We're trying to prevent buying judges. So if the judge is recusing, then no judge has been bought. So that's really that exception there, but there is a gift ban. So anybody that tells you there's not a gift ban, there's a gift ban. It's just a question of degrees, and you know, we can certainly have debates over degrees, but I just want to make sure that everybody understands that that is actually in the canons. And finally, the fourth canon that we'll talk about is political campaigner activities. I'll talk about this a little bit later, how often this comes up, but obviously judges are not supposed to engage in any political activities when they're not during an election, in an election year. For purposes of that, an election year essentially starts after the general election in the prior year. So next year, or this year, 2018, there'll be a general election. After that general election is over, any judicial candidates that are going to run for office in 2019, they're off to the races. But in terms of this election year, a judge cannot engage in any political activities. Of course, that doesn't work for candidates because you know, candidates who are not judges, they can, of course, continue to engage in political activities. But again, the idea is that judges, sitting judges, should not be engaging in political activities unless, of course, they are running for office. So, just to summarize the various ways in which judges are regulated in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. There's the Pennsylvania Constitution itself, Article 5, Section 17 and 18. There's the Code of Judicial Conduct dealing with judges and justices of the Pennsylvania Supreme Court, and there's the rules governing magisterial district judges. There's also, which we'll touch on a little bit later, the Judicial Conduct Board and the Court of Judicial Discipline, both of which have operating procedures and rules of procedures that judges have to abide by. There are supervisory orders on judicial conduct from the Pennsylvania Supreme Court. These include recently enacted orders dealing with the requirement that judges get continuing judicial education. Also deal with orders requiring judges to file annual financial statements, disclosure statements. And then there's the actual decisions of the Pennsylvania Supreme Court, decisions of the Court of Judicial Discipline and Special Tribunal, which I'll talk about in a little bit as well. But basically decisions that adjudicate violations of either the Constitution or the Code or any other provisions dealing with judicial misconduct. These are all of the things in Pennsylvania that judges have to be thinking about, be cognizant of, and that the public should be cognizant of, because these are the standards against which our conduct as judges are rated. So that's a lot for anybody to be aware of, whether you're a judge or someone in the public. It's a lot of information, a lot of rules, a lot of canons, a lot of decisions. So if you know nothing about the Code of Judicial Conduct, if you know nothing about what the Constitution says about what judges should do, you can apply what I call the gut test. And the gut test has several components to it. So the first one is, how would a person of ordinary reasonable sensibilities react to something you're about to do? If it's not something you want your mother to know about, you probably shouldn't do it. So that's the first one. The headline test, right? Would the judge mind seeing a headline in tomorrow's newspaper reporting that the judge engaged in that conduct? If seeing your name on the headline indicating that you did that is something you really don't want to see, then don't do it. Is the conduct undignified, or does it otherwise reflect poorly under the judiciary? Now, I guess undignified is in the eye of the beholder. See the mom test, is what I would say. Is the conduct unlawful? That's pretty easy. If you're about to engage in unlawful conduct and you value your job, you value your position, or you value the judiciary itself as an institution, don't do it. I had a little post-traumatic stress when I did this chart because I was an accounting major and we used a lot of flow charts when I was an undergrad. So the idea of putting together a flow chart again just scared me a little bit. But so a judge messes up, right? A judge violates something, does something the judge shouldn't do. How does this all work? What happens? So if you look from the misconduct complaint, there's a dotted line on this flowchart to PA Senate. That's a dotted line because it's a reference to the I word, impeachment. Impeachment has always been an option in the Pennsylvania Constitution to remove a public officer. It's rarely used, but it has always been an option, but I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about it. The only point I will mention about the impeachment process is, if the impeachment process is started, the Constitution actually provides that the judge may not exercise his or her judicial duties until acquittal. So the actual beginning of the process is an automatic suspension on the judge. That's all I'll say about the Senate and impeachment. Up until the Pennsylvania Constitution of 1968, there was no specific method for judicial discipline other than impeachment in Pennsylvania. After the 1968 Constitution, there was a body created within the judiciary called the Judicial Inquiry and Review Board. The Judicial Inquiry and Review Board was appointed by the Pennsylvania Supreme Court, and it was a one-stop shop. They did the investigation. They took the complaints, they did the investigation, they held the hearings, and then they made recommendations to the Pennsylvania Supreme Court on discipline. In a similar sense, it's very similar to the attorney disciplinary process that we have right now in Pennsylvania. Again, the board only really made a recommendation to the Supreme Court. It was really up to the Supreme Court to decide the matter de novo or anew. That all changed, though, in amendments to the Constitution in 1993. There was an amendment in the Constitution in 1993 following a very public judicial misconduct case involving a Pennsylvania Supreme Court justice that not only went through the judicial conduct process, but also went through an impeachment process in the Senate. So the framers of the Constitution, constitutional amendment was put into place. I think it went through a referendum and was voted on by the people, actually. And the idea was we moved to a two-tier structure. And in that two-tier structure, we have the Supreme Court's role has become limited. The Supreme Court's role is limited to they have an appointment power on one of the two bodies that were created by the constitutional amendment, and then they serve as an appellate body on an appeal from the court that was created under the constitutional amendment. And so that's the process that I really want to focus on in this chart. So we have a misconduct complaint. How does it work? Well, there's a dotted line over to the Pennsylvania. I talked about the dotted line to the Pennsylvania Senate. Let me really quickly talk about the dotted line to the Pennsylvania Supreme Court. There was recently a case where the Pennsylvania Supreme Court decided that there needed to be an interim suspension of a magisterial district judge or at that kind of a level. I think it might have been in the city of Philadelphia, but I'm not sure. While there was a judicial conduct proceeding pending in the Court of Judicial Discipline involving the same judge and involving the misconduct, and you had a conflict. And the conflict was that the Court of Judicial Discipline said that judge should be suspended without or with pay. And then the Supreme Court jumped in and said the judge should be suspended without pay. So there was a conflict between what the Court of Judicial Discipline did and what the Pennsylvania Supreme Court did. So the dotted line is a reference to the opinion that was issued by the Pennsylvania Supreme Court in that case. The Pennsylvania Supreme Court has reserved unto itself, pursuant to its King's Bench power, which is a reference to Old England, but the idea basically that the Pennsylvania Supreme Court is the head of the judicial branch in Pennsylvania and exercises supervisory power over all judges and all courts in Pennsylvania. And what the Supreme Court has basically said is, in very rare and exceptional circumstances, we are going to step in to protect the integrity of the judiciary and impose some form of discipline on a judge where appropriate, usually a suspension or something of that nature. It's supposed to be very rarely exercised, but that dotted line is a reference to, again, a limited exception to what I'm going to really focus on. What I'm really going to focus on is the process that we have generally now as it is understood. So a misconduct complaint comes in, and then what happens is the misconduct complaint is filed with the Judicial Conduct Board. Eventually, if the Judicial Conduct Board determines that there's probable cause of misconduct, the Judicial Conduct Board will file a complaint in the Court of Judicial Discipline. That's the court that adjudicates the misconduct challenge or complaint in the first instance. And then ultimately there could be an appeal from that dispute or from that decision, the Court of Judicial Discipline, to one of two places. The first place is the Pennsylvania Supreme Court. Now, we have approximately 1,250 judicial officers in Pennsylvania. Subtract from that Supreme Court justices. When the Constitution was created, or when the Constitution was amended to create this two-tier structure, the idea was, well, Supreme Court justices shouldn't be the appellate body to review judicial misconduct of Supreme Court justices. So what the Constitution provides for is a special tribunal of seven commissioned judges drawn at random from the two intermediate appellate courts, that being the Commonwealth Court or the Supreme Court. So the reference the arrow from the Court of Judicial Discipline to the Special Tribunal is limited to those instances where a Supreme Court justice is implicated. Let's talk about the Judicial Conduct Board. The Judicial Conduct Board is an independent agency within the judiciary, created by Article 5, Section 18A of the Constitution. Basically, that's where you would file a complaint for judicial misconduct. Their power of the Judicial Conduct Board is to investigate the complaint for judicial misconduct and, if probable cause, to file a complaint to prosecute it. Note again in the mission statement of the Judicial Conduct Board that's up on the screen, the themes that I mentioned to you earlier about dignity, independence, and integrity. I've had the pleasure of being on the Judicial Conduct Board, as I said, since August 2015. The people on the Judicial Conduct Board have been appointed. They're unpaid, and a lot of work goes into this. I'm very honored to serve with those people. I've been at multiple meetings with them, and I can attest to you, for what it's worth, that every time they have to exercise their discretion, they do it with the utmost understanding that what they're doing is a very important job under the Pennsylvania Constitution, and that it's important for them to fairly decide these matters and to protect the integrity of the judiciary. How do they do that is very important, and they do that two ways, by promptly dismissing unfounded complaints and by vigorously prosecuting the founded ones. It probably doesn't surprise you that judges tend to make people mad. Usually they're making half the people mad and half the people happy, but you can understand that some people may be complaining about conduct of judges, and a lot of complaints do get filed. So the integrity of the judicial system is protected, yes, by prosecuting the founded complaints, by prosecuting judicial misconduct, but it's also protected by weeding out those unfounded complaints. And that's a very important role of the Judicial Conduct Board. The Judicial Conduct Board is made up of 16 members. This is, again, something that I don't think a lot of people have a good understanding of. They're not all appointed by the Pennsylvania Supreme Court. Half are actually appointed by the governor. Half are appointed by the Supreme Court. The governor appoints a common pleas court judge. The Supreme Court appoints an appellate court judge, whether it's from the Commonwealth Court or the Superior Court, and an MDJ. But basically, the governor appoints three non-lawyers, two lawyers, and one common pleas judge. So the governor gets half of those appointments. Supreme Court, three non-lawyers, one lawyer, one appellate court judge, and one magisterial district judge. No senior judges, so any of the judges' appointment have to be current commission judges. And there is a 3-of-6 rule. So the 3-of-6 rule is that you can appoint no more than 3 of your 6 appointments from the same political party. So assuming there are only 2 political parties, you would think that would be evenly distributed, but I was corrected the other day that, well, you could appoint an independent, a registered independent. But the point is, no party, Republican or Democrat, is going to have a majority of seats on the Judicial Conduct Board. So let's review this for a minute, because I think this is pretty impactful. The Judicial Conduct Board is made up of a body appointed half by the executive branch. And it guarantees at least half of the seats are going to be held by non-lawyers. If the magisterial district judge happens to be a non-lawyer, that's a majority of non-lawyers, right? So, but at least half of the seats are going to be non-lawyers. No one political party dominates, has a majority. I'm not sure that any other branch in state government has that kind of oversight. Nobody is knocking on my door to sit on a commission to evaluate the ethics of the state legislature. And I don't think they have a lot of non-legislator citizen commissions, for that matter, reviewing the conduct of the state legislator or the executive branch. So this is an important aspect of our oversight of judges in Pennsylvania. I indicated that the Judicial Conduct Board has an investigative power. So they sort of have this power to investigate generally. So what does that mean? Well, the power to investigate generally means if they get a complaint in, they can do this sort of snooping around, right? They can look at public dockets. They can sit in actual courtrooms if it's a demeanor complaint about a judge. So that's kind of surveillance for a crazy, you know, snoopy kind of word. And they can interview witnesses or interview a complainant. There's any number of non-coercive measures that the board can engage in to investigate complaints. They also have the power to issue subpoenas. And those subpoenas are issued by the Judicial Conduct Board, and any challenges to those subpoenas are actually decided by my court, the Commonwealth Court of Pennsylvania. This is also very important to point. The Judicial Conduct Board is not a criminal investigative agency. Yes, some judicial misconduct is also a crime, but the Judicial Conduct Board does not have investigative powers. They do not have the powers to get search warrants. They don't have the ability to put up a grand jury. So it's really more of a civil investigative agency than you would think that it's criminal. So they don't have those kind of broad tools. And what is it looking for? I mentioned this earlier. The board's obligation is to determine from a complaint, from its investigation, whether there is probable cause of judicial misconduct, probable cause to file formal charges in the Court of Judicial Discipline. Judicial misconduct I spoke about previously, and that, you know, we've gone through the canons, the Constitution, rules, opinions, things like that. Under the Constitution, there is also a question whether there's probable cause that the judge suffers from any sort of mental, medical, or physical disability. That happens from time to time. It includes, unfortunately, addiction, alcohol addiction or drug addiction, which happens all too frequently in our profession. It can happen to judges as well. There's also physical disability. And the Constitution actually contemplates that jurists will be given an opportunity to resign or seek rehabilitation as alternatives to airing these very personal matters in the public. From the Judicial Conduct Board's perspective, what the goal is, though, is to exercise, it's an exercise in being compassionate for the jurist who might suffer from a medical or physical disability, but while ensuring that the public is not harmed. So it's a balancing process. Sources of complaints. Surprise of all surprise, litigants, right? I mentioned that. You know, we're making half the people angry half the time. Surprising amount from prisoners, pro se prisoners filing complaints about judges, sentencing decisions, things like that. Also, domestic cases, family law cases, divorce. We get a lot of complaints from litigants in those cases as well. Family members of litigants, they're complaining that their son, their daughter, their father, their mother got a bum rap in the court. Complaints from the public. We see that a lot. And then the list goes on and on. Board and chief counsel, we as a board or our chief counsel will sometimes open complaints. That usually comes about when we see something covered in the media. If you read that a judge somewhere did something and it's made the media before anybody has ever filed a complaint, the board will act to open up its own complaint in the matter. And then, of course, we receive anonymous complaints. We do receive anonymous complaints. The board receives, I mentioned there's like 1,250 or so judges under the jurisdiction of the disciplinary process in Pennsylvania. The board receives and opens roughly 800 complaints a year. So I think it's a lot. But it's important because the role of the we review all of those complaints. So that's part of the job of the Judicial Conduct Board. Another source, judges. Judges actually have a duty in appropriate circumstances to file or notify the court of the Judicial Conduct Board if the judge has a reasonable belief that another judge is impaired, suffers from an addiction or a physical impairment that is affecting the discharge of their duties of office or prejudicing justice. Judge must also act where they have knowledge or information of actual judicial misconduct. So not just instances of impairment, but also where there's actual judicial misconduct. And of course, self-report. If a judge engages in judicial misconduct, usually the judge has been, in these circumstances perhaps, got pulled over for a DUI or was charged with some kind of a crime, the judge has an obligation to self-report that conduct, not only to the Supreme Court of Pennsylvania, but also to the Judicial Conduct Board. Self-reports go a long way, as we'll see later in the presentation. I indicated that the Judicial Conduct Board reviews and processes a lot of complaints. Our obligation is to review and process every complaint. So how does the Judicial Conduct Board dispose of the complaints? First of all, one of the options is there could be no action. That's rare. But sometimes you get a complaint in and you look at it, usually an anonymous complaint, but not, and you just look at it and you go, yeah, no. There's just nothing here. So in those instances, no action on the complaint. That'll happen. Rare, again, but sometimes it happens and we just don't proceed with it. Then there are called what's dismissals after preliminary inquiry, or DAPIs. These are really interesting words that I didn't know before I came on the Judicial Conduct Board, but a DAPI. That's essentially that we've opened up the complaint, we reviewed the complaint, we've investigated the complaint, but there's still nothing there. There's no reason to proceed further. So what that could be is it could be merits-based. It could be jurisdictionally based. Say the complaint was filed against a federal judge, which the Court of Judicial Discipline in Pennsylvania doesn't deal with federal judges. We deal with state judges. It could have been filed against an administrative hearing officer in the executive branch. Again, we don't deal with those folks. We deal with judges under Article 5 jurisdiction of the Constitution. It could be a statute of limitations situation. It could be a complaint from a judge about a judge that happened more than 4 years ago. Generally, if the complaint is about conduct that happened more than 4 years ago, the Judicial Conduct Board will not open up a complaint. Now, there is an exception for good cause shown, but there's a general rule of a four-year look-back period. Then, under dismissals after preliminary investigation, there's sort of this subcategory called a SLED. SLED is a strictly legal error dismissal. Again, judges sometimes make mistakes, but that's what your appeal right is for. The appeal corrects the mistakes. Just because a judge made a legal error doesn't mean you can file a misconduct complaint against them in the court, in the Judicial Conduct Board. You can, but it's all likely going to result in a SLED or a strictly legal error dismissal. Notice of full investigation, or a NAFI, is not really a disposition. But what the notice of full investigation said is the preliminary inquiry at least indicated that there might be something there. So this, but under the Constitution, you have to give the judicial officer a formal notice. So you issue what's called a notice of full investigation. Credible allegations set forth in the complaint after a preliminary investigation, proceeding to a full investigation, the judge or justice has an opportunity to respond to what we found in the investigation and the charges in the complaint. Letter of caution. Letters of caution are issued by the Judicial Conduct Board if, after a notice of full investigation, the board has determined that maybe there wasn't, or there probably isn't probable cause to file a complaint, but this is an aberration. This is an oversight. This is something that we should probably let the judge know. You didn't cross the line, but be careful. So that's the letter of caution. Basically a constructive wake-up call for the jurist. Then there are letters of counsel. Letters of counsel are is for more egregious conduct. A letter of counsel is where the board could file a complaint in the Court of Judicial Discipline, but for some mitigating reason, usually because there was a no harm by the conduct and because the jurist's record is otherwise spotless, that this was sort of an outlier, a letter of counsel will be issued. Generally, to get a letter of counsel, the judge has to show some level of remorse. They have to generally admit that, yeah, I messed up. I'm sorry. It'll never happen again. To get a letter of counsel, though, the jurist has to agree to it. They have to agree to it because if they mess up again after getting a letter of counsel, the conduct that was the subject of the letter of counsel can be charged. So that's why they have to agree to it. They also have to agree, as part of the letter of counsel, to come into the Judicial Conduct Board and sit down with the chief counsel and be counseled by the chief counsel and potentially a board member of the Judicial Conduct Board. All of these dispositions in here, letter of counsel, I put resignation in. And I talked about that previously, about the Constitution provision that allows judges to resign in the case of mental and physical disability. I won't go into that much further than that. All of these dispositions are confidential. So the question is, why? I'm not making this up. The answer is it's in the Constitution. This isn't something that judges are just trying to hide what's happening or things like that. This is actually, confidentiality is required in the Constitution. And why? Why is it in there? Well, I wasn't there when the language was put in, but I can have some, I can speculate a little bit. We want people to file legitimate complaints. And therefore, we don't want every complaint to become public because people might be chilled into filing legitimate complaints against judges. So that may be one reason why it's in there. We also don't want judges or courts smeared by the mere filing of a complaint that might later be determined to be unfounded. Remember, one of the goals that we have here is to ensure the public's confidence in the judiciary. And that confidence can be shaken every time a complaint is announced against a judge or a court. So an accusation alone can cause people to lose confidence in a judge or lose confidence in the court. So that's why I think the voters decided to put this in the Pennsylvania Constitution. There are exceptions. A jurist can waive confidentiality if the jurist wants to waive confidentiality. There's also an exception if something gets made public, meaning it's out in the media already, and the board feels that it's in the best interest of the public and the judiciary to get out there and make a statement, the board can make a statement. So there are some exceptions to confidentiality. So Judicial Conduct Board, types of complaints. Mistakes. Judges make mistakes. Mistakes will probably result in either a dismissal or maybe sometimes a letter of caution, but mistakes happen. Judges sometimes do stupid things. Stupid things will probably get you a letter of caution or a letter of counsel. It could result in a charge with the Court of Judicial Discipline if you've made a lot of stupid mistakes. But stupid mistakes generally will keep you out of the Court of Judicial Discipline. I'm scared of clowns. Sometimes judges do evil things. Some make mistakes, some are stupid, some are just evil. They commit crimes. They misuse their office. They exert bias or prejudice in a court proceeding to the detriment of a party. That will usually, if not always, result in a charge in the Court of Judicial Discipline. It also could result in an agreed-to resignation with a promise not to run for future judicial office. Because at the end of the day, that's really the ultimate sanction that can be issued against someone who has committed the most egregious form of misconduct, is losing their job and being barred from running for judicial office. I'm going to skip ahead a little bit to the Court of Judicial Discipline. Court of Judicial Discipline, same setup. Should surprise no one after seeing the Judicial Conduct Board set up that we have a Court of Judicial Discipline that is made up of appointees by the Supreme Court and the executive branch. They have 4-year terms. They have a similar rule on political affiliations. Executive branch appoints half the seats. Guaranteed at least half the seats will be non-judges. Not one political party dominates. Again, something that you see only in the oversight of the judicial branch. The Court of Judicial Discipline is the court of record. They have the powers of interim suspension. This is where things become public, because all of our courts are open. But this is where things become public. Discovery is available, and we can always have to remember that, like in any court, in any court of law, the jurist has the presumption of innocence. The Judicial Conduct Board, at this point in time, probable cause isn't enough. The Judicial Conduct Board, who prosecutes, must prove the misconduct by clear and convincing evidence. The Court of Judicial Discipline must issue findings of fact and conclusions of law. Why is that important? Because it's not just important for the judge that's the subject of the misconduct, but it's important to inform judges throughout the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania what their standard of conduct is expected of them. Options. The judge got convicted. What can the Court of Judicial Discipline do? They can remove the judge from office, obviously reserved for the most egregious misconduct. They can suspend with or without pay. They can censure. And then in the Constitution, there's this phrase of otherwise discipline. That has been interpreted to mean that the Court of Judicial Discipline can impose a fine. That's actually a recent thing. They've only recently gone the fine route. They can reprimand, which I still don't understand what the difference is between a reprimand and a censure, but they can reprimand and censure. And then, of course, there is this idea of probation or diversion, which I'll get into in a few seconds. How do they determine it? There's this case out of Washington called In re Deming. These are referred to what are called the Deming factors. So these are the factors that generally are applied across the country when evaluating sanctions for judicial misconduct. They're pretty much what you would expect. Look at the judge's length of judicial service. Is this an aberration? Is this a one-time situation? Is it isolated? Was it inside or outside the courtroom? all those kind of things. History of complaints or discipline against the judge. Is there a history of complaints or discipline? But these are sort of a non-exclusive list of factors that when you're assessing an appropriate sanction for a judge, that the court of judicial discipline will look at. Okay, congratulations. You have all been appointed to the court of judicial discipline. Don't get excited. You've had your crash course. A judge has pled guilty to a first offense DWI. During the stop, the judge told the officer that this stop could hurt him more than most because of his position. He also told the officer that he could not tell the officer what his position was because that too would get him into trouble. But when asked later if he had, when asked if he had been drinking, the judge lied to the police officer. And then later at the police station, the judge told the officer that he was a judge and asked whether the officer had any discretion at this point in time in the way that he could handle the matter. Okay, your turn. Show of hands. Private sanction. Okay. Public reprimand or censure. Okay. So public reprimand or sanction beats out private sanction, folks. Okay. How about suspension? Ooh, raise them high. I know, Professor Family, suspension get higher more than public reprimand? Okay, so we've moved up to suspension. Removal. Wow, you guys are harsh. But I still think suspension won. Anybody want to come up with something else? Be creative? No? Okay. So this was an actual case from New Jersey. The judge was actually found to have violated the Canon 1, maintaining the high standard of conduct, Canon 2A, conduct that conducting self in a manner that promotes confidence in the public, and misuse of the prestige of office. The irony about this is the judge actually knew he was misusing the prestige of office, right? Because he actually said to the police officer, "I can't really tell you who I am." And then later on says, "Let me tell you who I am." So in this case, censure. The Advisory Committee on Judicial Conduct censured the judge, which, by the way, they considered to be severe, a severe sanction. But in addition to that, the Supreme Court in that case approved the censure, but also precluded the judge from hearing DWI matters for 1 year. Probably a good idea. Let's do one more. A married judge began a Facebook and texting relationship with a woman he had met in his official capacity as a judge. She was a former litigant. Communications included sexually explicit dialogue, photographs. When I say photographs, I mean really sexually explicit photographs. And propositions for sexual encounters. Really explicit propositions for sexual encounters. The judge engaged in this conduct during normal working hours. One of the sexually explicit photos was taken and transmitted while the judge was in the courthouse. The judge's Facebook page identifies him as a judge and has a picture of him in his robe. While these messages were supposedly private, they became public when the woman went to the media. And the media released them. The messages did identify the judge, by the way, by his name and title, Judge blah, 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 in the messages back and forth. Apparently the judge used this thing called Facebook Messenger. I don't really, anybody who's in my privacy class knows that I really don't know, purposefully, I know not a lot about social media because I don't do it. So apparently used Facebook Messenger. Okay, here we go. Court of Judicial Discipline, here we go. Private sanction. Okay. For those on PCN, not a single hand. Public reprimand and censure. One. Ooh, a couple of people, look at that. Wow. They're not raising their hand very high, by the way. But there are some public reprimand and censure. Suspension. Suspension's looking pretty good right now. Removal. Okay. You think removal? Anybody want to throw something else in? Want to, or otherwise him? No? Well, one of the Widener professors suggested tarring and feathering. Okay, so the State Commission in this case, you want to know how this turned out? The State Commission in this case surprisingly found that the judge had committed several violations of the Code of Conduct. They suspended him without pay for 180 days and ordered counseling. Yeah, see, or otherwise, right? You know, counseling. So you can see why it's not really that easy of a job trying to figure these things out. Some stuff in the pipeline as I'm summing up to stay tuned about. There's going to be some work by the Judicial Conduct Board on dealing with a diversionary program for judges. The Court of Judicial Discipline actually has sort of an informal process in place right now for diversionary programs. The idea is here the judge engaged in a conduct, usually a pattern of conduct, that is usually, I would say, more demeanor-based than anything else. That the judge is exercising some poor temperament, either with the staff or with parties. This is a way to get it out into the public, number one, because the public already knows about it one way or another because of the reputation of the jurors. But to say, you know what, the judge is not irredeemable. So we're going to find a way to either mentor the judge or counsel the judge in the hopes that at the end of this period of time of diversion, perhaps there'll be a better judge and it won't be necessary to go forward with the charges. Discipline on consent is also something that the Judicial Conduct Board is looking at. This is an idea of essentially a judge saying, yep, I did it. But it's the conduct was at least egregious enough that it has to be public and it has to be in front of the Court of Judicial Discipline. But the judge is basically saying, I did it. And there's really no reason to have a trial. There's agreed to facts. The judge is admitting to certain charges. And there's a proposal for a solution. And it's up to the Court of Judicial Discipline whether to take it. So that's something that we're going to be looking at. It's in a lot of other jurisdictions. We just don't have it in Pennsylvania yet, but it may be something that's coming. Something that's also going to be interesting to watch, social media. We just had the social media fact pattern, right? Social media fact pattern from hell. You know, that's what I often get worried about, social media. That's why I stopped Facebook. Not that I'm going to engage in that stuff. That's not what I'm worried about. Okay. Rewind that. Social media is not private. It's not just a matter of what I do. It's what other people can put on my Facebook page. It's what other people can say. It's what people can friend you and things like that. There's just a lot of things that you can get wrapped up in social media that unfortunately can look bad on the judiciary. So I personally try to stay away from most social media. But social media is becoming ubiquitous, right? A lot of people are engaging in it. Even judges are engaging it throughout the country. And so at some point in time, I think everybody's anxiety about social media is going to go away, because at some point in time, people are going to say, well, friends on Facebook aren't really friends, right? They're something really shy of friend, but they just use friends. So that's something to look at as well. Okay, to sum up, before I take a few questions, so one of the things that I have the pleasure of doing as a father is I coach my son's baseball team, and I notoriously complain about the umpires, because that's what coaches do, right? That's part of our job, is we're supposed to complain about the umpires. But judicial discipline is a lot like baseball, and it's a lot like baseball because we leave it to people. We leave it to human beings to make the decisions. People sometimes make mistakes. People sometimes do stupid things, and people are sometimes evil. The goal of the judicial discipline system is to weed out the evil people and to try and remedy the mistakes. All of these decisions aren't made by institutions. They're not made by computers. They're made by people. They're made by people in the Court of Judicial Discipline. many of them who are non-lawyers. They're made by people on the Judicial Conduct Board who serve as volunteers. They're made by the dedicated staff of both institutions who I'm having the pleasure of work with, and I want to thank them for their service. I want to thank the people I serve with on the Court of the Judicial Conduct Board. I also want to thank the staff. I want to thank former Superior Court Judge Bob Gracie, who is the chief counsel for the Judicial Conduct Board, for his efforts in helping me put this presentation together. Judge Gracie would have done a much better job than me, because Judge Gracie actually does this similar presentation to judges in Pennsylvania. But I want to thank him. It's important. If you ever see judicial misconduct, if you ever see a judge not upholding the standard that we are expected to uphold in the Constitution, I urge you to file complaints with the Judicial Conduct Board. Not because I think we need more work, but because that's the work that we do. So I encourage you to hold us to the highest standard of integrity, and that's what I will continue to strive to do, both as a judge on Commonwealth Court, but also as a member of the Judicial Conduct Board. And with that, if we have some time, we'll take some questions.